One advantage that Napoleon had establishing his empire, in addition to his effective use of the French army, was that he was able to reinstate many members of the old nobility who had been discredited or even imprisoned by the revolution. He even allowed some aristocrats to reclaim some of the property that the revolutionaries had taken away from them. Napoleon also introduced a new civil code in 1804 that completely revamped the French legal system and is still in use today. The code, which was designed by a panel of four eminent judges, replaced France's old feudal legal system and has been tremendously influential in Europe and elsewhere in the world as nations have developed modern legal systems. In a series of wars between 1804 and 1807, Napoleon extended French control to much of Germany, Italy, Spain, and the Duchy of Warsaw, and he built strong alliances with Austria and Prussia. At its height, the French Empire ruled over 70 million subjects. And to try to secure its most profitable colony, Napoleon sent 40,000 troops across the Atlantic to Hispaniola to try to retake Saint-Dominique from an army of rebellious former slaves led by Toussaint Louverture, one of the most important leaders of the revolutionary age. Encouraged by the French Revolution, slaves on sugar plantations on Hispaniola, which the French had renamed Saint-Dominique, rebelled in 1791 and overthrew the white government of the island. Slavery in the French colonies was then abolished by the Jacobins in 1793, one of the few things that Robespierre got right. And the army of former slaves then fought a British invasion to a standstill in a five-year war that ended in 1798. But after declaring himself Emperor of the French, Napoleon reinstituted slavery and sent troops to try to retake the island for France. Napoleon's army, which outnumbered the Haitian forces 2-1, captured Toussaint Louverture in 1803 and transported him to a French prison where he died. But the revolution continued under Louverture's lieutenant Jean-Jacques Dessalines. The former slaves defeated the French and formally established the Republic of Haiti in 1804. Although the author of the Declaration of Independence, Thomas Jefferson, was president when Haiti became the first ever nation created by former slaves who gained their freedom in an armed rebellion, and only the second American republic to free itself from European colonialism, the author of the Declaration refused to recognize Haiti's independence. The slavery-supporting South actually blocked recognition of Haiti by the U.S. government until the Civil War, when a North-only Congress and President Lincoln were finally able to establish diplomatic relations in 1862. Another momentous act of Napoleon's was his sale of 828,000 square miles of North America to the U.S. in 1804. The expense of the failed war to prevent Haitian independence and the prospect of a new war with Britain in Europe convinced Napoleon to take 50 million francs, about $11 million in today's money, for a territory that he had just regained from Spain. President Thomas Jefferson had originally been interested in buying only the port city of New Orleans at the mouth of the Mississippi River, which was important because it was where produce from the interior arrived via the Mississippi. But the territory that he acquired in the Louisiana Purchase actually doubled the size of the U.S. As you can see from this 1804 map, people living in the United States were generally aware of how big North America was between the Mississippi River and the Rocky Mountains, but they were a bit hazy about what lay between the Rockies and the Pacific. Revolution and nationalism are related, but the relationship is complicated. In the case of the United States and Haiti, revolution led to the creation of new nations. In France, revolution led to chaos and to Napoleon's attempt at empire building. Napoleon's empire might have lasted a little bit longer if he had not been so interested in expanding it to include not only Europe and Haiti, but also Russia. In a final example of bad judgment, Napoleon invaded Russia and occupied Moscow in September of 1812. Russia's fast-moving Cossack cavalry executed a scorched earth retreat before the advancing French army, so Napoleon's forces arrived in Moscow hungry. only to find that the city's 250,000 people had all abandoned their homes and taken everything that they could carry. The French burned the city, possibly by accident, and then they began a long retreat in early October at the beginning of what turned out to be a brutal winter. To make matters worse, the Russian cavalry, which hadn't been defeated, repeatedly cut French supply lines. Of the original force of over 600,000 men, only about 100,000 made it back to France alive. Napoleon was able to build the army back up again, although replacing the horses that the troops had eaten during their retreat was a little bit harder. But this crushing, embarrassing debacle proved to the world that he maybe wasn't the military genius that they had believed him to be. Napoleon's enemies invaded France in 1814, forcing him to abdicate, and they exiled him to Elba, a small island near his boyhood home of Corsica. Napoleon escaped the Mediterranean island and regained power briefly in 1815 before being defeated at Waterloo and then exiled to St. Helena in the South Pacific, which he did not escape from, and where he died 6 years later at the age of 51. So before we move on, a couple more questions for discussion. Why was Napoleon willing to sell Louisiana to Thomas Jefferson? And secondly, what prevented the U.S. government from recognizing Haiti?